Hello, I'm Anne, and you're watching CSO Executive Sessions. Joining me on the show today is Eric Nguyen. Eric is an AI and cybersecurity advisor at the University of Canberra's Open Source Institute in Australia. Welcome, Eric. Thanks for coming on the show.
Hi, Anne. It's my pleasure.
So you've come on to talk to us about supply chain risks in critical infrastructure. Can you tell us what you're observing across the Asia Pacific region? What's trending right now, and are there emerging threats we need to watch out for?
Thank you, Anne, for the questions. In terms of the trends that we can observe in the Asia Pacific region, in 2024, what we anticipate since early of the year. For example, if I look back at one of the articles that published on the CSO that you posed the question to 24 security leaders in the region, infrastructure is definitely part of that conversation, and the trend confirmed now with as we can see a couple of things like in terms of critical infrastructure, the number, the volume of attack just exposed exponential. However, now we can observe some emerging trend from the attack, from, let's say, organized crime or state-sponsored actors. Now we do see another trend emerge, which is around those end-of-life IT assets or unsupported software. It becomes the new opportunity for not just bad actor but also even insider threat to make use of. And in the end, we can see a number. Definitely, there's a growing number of incident all across critical infrastructure in the region. You can see it in Japan as a significant increase in thermal blade attack on healthcare, as well as small to medium second tier or third tier manufacturer, all the way to places like, say, Vietnam or Singapore. The attack emerged an incident, ransomware, as well as insider threat. Those events. It also highlight, I think, one of the from our observation, the key differences between the approach in the region versus like other regions globally, say in Europe or in the US. The importance of critical infrastructure has been embedded into regulation and well understood sectors, and also the approach is more, we say, holistic approach. You have regulation, you have best practice, you have people, tool set, and also benchmark. Whereas in Asia Pacific, this is why we still have some gap. We tend to go for something, I think it is in the Asian like approach. We go for point solution. When we see the fire, we will try to put down the fire. And as a result, the supply chain is like everything connected onto the others in the region. We did not really uplift the overall standard. So as a consequence, we will see, I think even in the next 12 months, we would see more and more sector that realize that they exposed to risk that can trace back to some on the ground. For example, end of life IT asset or open source technology embedded service and software, or even data center. It is also one of the emerging threats in the region.
Right. You mentioned earlier that the number of attacks have grown exponentially. What are some evolving tactics that cyber criminals are using to exploit supply chain vulnerabilities?
In terms of the try to see it is there any correlation between the level of sophistication of the technique or the tool set with the volume? Unfortunately, it wasn't that simple correlation. Yes, the attacker or criminal, like other criminals, they do basically lead this kind of like game, cat and mouse game, where they exploit the vulnerability, and they sometimes within 24 hours they can come up with the proof of concept for act. However, I would say most of the time those incident did not come from those novel attack. It was mainly still the same trick, still the same approach. For example, the number one, still phishing. It is still like a very effective. However, this year we witness, from my observation, we witness more attack via, let's say, PDF file, for example, rather than have a link and then you click on the link. User will not like do it now. However, they will attach the PDF, and the PDF embedded malicious code, and that is the new gateway for organization. The other thing I have to call it out is also about the readiness of IT security at organizations across. In order to filter out or identify if there's any embedded code in any PDF file, it would take some investment as well as upskilling people, as well as the right setup. So then you will have the level of confidence. Of course, however, most of the organization simply either these will not be there for everything. So yeah, there's still a big gap there for pitching.
That's really interesting. And when we speak of critical infrastructure, it can be pretty broad, spanning different industries and various types of facilities and systems, not to mention the complexity of the supply chain itself. Are there any particular areas that are most vulnerable to a security breach?
I would say most vulnerable is also on its own. It's a very difficult criteria to because here we need to think about, let's say, the impact versus the likelihood of happening. So, for example, for a vulnerability might be super critical for, let's say, in the health industry. However, it is okay. It is not that important compared for, let's say, of like utility or the utility type of utility. If there is some issue with, let's say, certain part of the OT system, for example, the worst scenario, we can shut it down. We stop and we replace the part. It's just a simple term, sure, there will be some impact on to the population, but it doesn't mean it is a life and death situation. On the other hand, at any hospital, for example, it is the attack is on this one machine, and that machine happened to be in the ICU, for example. It is like not just one person in danger, it could be many people. So that on its own, I would say, when we talk about vulnerability, it had to be out of context. Over my time, I try to bring closer to the meaning of what are we talking about here, and from that context, we can bring in leverage and the story and also the setup to get the buy-in from the broader organization. Now back to your question about, let's say, in terms of like vulnerable in enterprise in the region, I can think of things like first of all, third-party vendors and suppliers. We can see it is a very complicated relationship. However, the true challenge is just not about the true challenge is just about whether you have the courage to work with your own people to basically have a big picture. It is not like one solo teams in the name of cyber who can work it out, or it is, let's say, pass the bucket, the procurement to sort it out.
Absolutely. And now, bearing all these things in mind, how should security leaders approach identifying and assessing cyber risks within their supply chain?
I think there's a great question in the number of ways. First, it just basically called it out that identity security is a priority. A leader needs to spend time and make the effort. But also it highlights the fact that this is a team sport. You cannot just work it out with the tool and with the tool app right now for several reasons. One, it is about the understanding of how the organization operates, not just as a function, not as an input and output, just measure the difference between people to say, hey, something wrong. It is the whole system, all ecosystem. Secondly, it is about the, I think it is the time that we can actually have some influence to the our colleague in across the organization. Example, finance, it is finance. It was about, okay, what did we buy? Who did we buy from? And any level of risk, we get what we need. Because so like, say, one supplier, and now they no longer exist. And last but not least, also about the something that is a big question among the leaders. It is about insurance, cyber insurance. It is also now has to be part of that conversation. The last thing I want to call out in terms of for leaders, security leaders, it is about the, it's not just about the safety of organization. It is also about the operations. And nowadays, we expect 24/7 seamless integration from one to the other part of the organization. So the expectation is really high. It is no longer just the 2 out of 3, like a golden triangle. You have a cost, you have the scope, and you have quality pick two. Now the expectation, as I usually say, is much higher. It is the diamond, it will be smarter, better, faster, and stronger with human design as a new expectation. So cybersecurity leaders, we cannot be just the gatekeeper anymore. If we think this is another light item, this is another cost to deliver the service, then I think we simply not keep up the expectation, the growing expectation, just from, let's say, within the company, or let's say, investor, or let's say, board, if it is, let's say, government, it would be from all the senior leaders, politicians, and even community. That's what I think.
And lastly, if you could neatly sum up your advice for security leaders, what would it be?
I would say a couple of things I can think of now. Very simple. First of all, it is about connected dots. In terms of supply chain security, it is not about we're going to buy new tools, hire new talents or none of above, but everything else. It is all about connected dots. But with what you already have, the people, the data that you have, and also the inside that whole company, as well as the ecosystem around the organization, have built up over the years, connect those dots, then you will be able to have a true current state picture. And from there, you can work out the blueprint. So first, it is about connecting dots. Secondly, it is about the triple A, poly triple A. It is actually built up of the follow up on the connected analytics, automation, and AI. So those three set of technology and empower what we have done with connected dots. Get the information, the insight, and the participation from people data we have and code. Number three, it would be around employee empowerment. It is absolutely critical. Pretty much call out that people on the ground who work day in, day out, let's say in the factory, they don't have something that you can pick up, put into the supply chain. Really, is that a good practice or any known issue that you would not be able to Google anywhere? You can ask people on the ground. Or even just like saying the bad practice, you pick up immediately and you can solve, let's say, 15% chance of an incident. For example, things like, say, with those industry industrial machinery, the system is all, a lot of them are bespoke software. So we tend to see people with USB plug in from one others and come back to the. So what if you see and observe it, a simple change in the process, basically verify those, like say, USB and only issue it with, like say, clear governance process and scan, already it reduced the chance that something might go wrong into this whole system. Trust me, like I along the way, I heard conversation where we just casually use like one USB for multiple tasks and just introduce, like say, the system. So I think employee empowerment is definitely the secret sauce for organization to drive a the supply chain security. And the other two point, like extra point that I need to also call out is number one is around the utilization of intelligence services. In another word, now that we look into those threat intelligence, however, I encourage leaders to consider the other source, open source intelligence. And now you're going to apply through the lens of the insight that you need to know. For example, if you have, let's say, you have a list of, let's say, 100 products that you know that you have in the organization, you can use those open source intelligence services, those products or vendors. And from there, basically, these services, they're going to scout through the internet, multiple languages, and give you that sort of like tools that you need in order to say, hey, it is actually something we need to it's not just about the threat and the patch and the active attack. It is like, say, the hidden part of the iceberg. So you have that visibility, you are better positioned yourself for the long future. And last but not least, it is about the culture, knowledge sharing among the industry as well as a region as well. So you should not be in this alone as well. Because the same things, like I said, anyone use Siemens heavy industry like the machinery, they should be able to share it with each other and learn rather than redo the same job, the same task, the same outcome. That is my thinking.
Fantastic. Well, thanks, Eric, for making time to speak with me today. And to our viewers, if you have any suggestions or feedback on the show, you can reach out to me on LinkedIn. Thanks for watching.